Begin with a prayer. God of strength and courage, in Jesus Christ, you set us free from sin and death and call us to risk, faith, and service. Give us grace to follow him who gave himself for others, that by our service we may find the life he came to bring. Amen. Our opening hymn is found on page 660. It's God is Here.
Amen.
seated. Our psalm today is Psalm 86, but it's not in the hymnal, so I just printed what I could onto the bulletin here. We'll read this responsively. Incline your ear, O Lord. Preserve my life. You are forgiving to those who call upon you. All nations shall recognize you and glorify your name. And before our scripture lessons, we have the prayer of illumination as printed in the bulletin. Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our hearts, minds, and hearts to the scriptures that you shared with us this morning. Our first lesson is from Genesis. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out the slave woman and her son, for the son of the slave woman shall not inherit with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed, because the boy and because your slave woman, whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that your offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And as she departed, she wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water skin was gone, she cast a child under the bushes. She went and sat down opposite of him a good way off, the distance of a bow shot, and she said, "Do not let me look upon the death of a child." And she sat opposite him, and she lifted her voice, and she wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven, and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy, hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a nation of him." When God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water, she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Their second reading is from Romans. Should we continue to sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead, the glory of the Father, so we might too walk with newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and that we might no longer be enslaved to sin, for whoever has died is free from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But if the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Our next hymn is found on page 560. It's Help Us Accept Each Other. Be seated for the gospel reading. Today we are continuing on from the story of the disciples being sent out. This is Jesus talking. We're reading from Matthew 10. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light. What you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear those who destroy both soul and body and can throw it into hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground unperceived by your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have come not to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set man against his father, and daughter against her mother, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, guys, I'm going to come forward here. Oh, I have to find a different spot. So, I'm just going to perch here. That's okay. So today is what I call a bittersweet day. You can listen to it. So, bittersweet is a fun word. It means something has complex flavors. Something is, it doesn't just have one flavor, it has a couple different things going on. So, do you know, actually, I'll let you answer me. What is something that has a bitter flavor? When you think of the word bitter, what do you think of? Chocolate, that's a really good one. Yep, chocolate without sugar, that's a hard one to eat. Anything else that's bitter? I think of a big one for adults is coffee. Coffee can be really bitter unless you put in sugar and milk. But for some reason, it seems like, or sometimes Swiss cheese tastes a little bitter to me, but it's kind of weird. The older you get, for some reason, you tend to like bitter things a little more. You tend to put sugar in with them, but your tongue develops to like complicated flavors. So, today is my last Sunday as pastor here, and that's something that is, I consider, fairly bitter, but it has been very sweet to have been here and to get to know people and to be able to speak. And the extra sweet thing is next Sunday, there'll be a new pastor. We really like her a lot. I think she's a really delightful person, and she will be here, and she will continue to lead this church. She will continue to see it grow. She will continue to bring people in. She has some plans and visions. So it's a little bit bitter because I don't get to be here. It's really sweet to see somebody else take over. So leaving the church as pastor is probably one of the harder things I've had to do, but it's a really joyful thing as well. So I have a sweet treat. You guys are gonna have to share it. I think watermelon can sometimes be a little bitter towards the edges, but the middle is really sweet. So you guys can share this if you want to. I hope you like gum. So anything I can pray for you guys for? One last time here. The Dharma's travel. Yeah. Anything else? Okay, let's pray. Holy God, you call us to new beginnings. At a time where sometimes we feel sad, we know that you are there to bring us joy as well. You're with us in both crying and in joy. Today we uplift a couple prayers. We ask for Grandma's travel back home, that she is able to be safe. We ask for prayers for those who are in sorrow and for those who are missing their loved ones. May you bring us back into your joy like you usually do. Thank you for all that you bring us. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Just come from the fountain, Lord, I've just come from the fountain. Oh, sister, do you love Jesus?
Yes, yes, I do love my Jesus.
Sister, do you love Jesus?
His name's so sweet.
Oh, Lord, I've
just come from the fountain. I've just come from the fountain. Lord, I've just come from the fountain. His name's so sweet.
Oh, sinner, do you love Jesus?
Yes, yes, I do love my Jesus.
Sinner, do you love Jesus?
His name's so sweet.
Oh, Lord, I've just come from the fountain.
I've just come from the fountain. Lord, I've just come from the fountain. His name's so sweet.
Oh, Lord, I've just come from the fountain.
I've just come from the fountain. Lord, I've just come from the fountain. His name's so sweet.
So my sermon title today is In the Light. I will admit, this was probably one of the hardest sermons I've ever had to write, for many reasons. So this will be my last week in the role of pastor, and that was a bit of a life curveball. But the last year of my journey up until this point has been kind of speckled with, well, the main word that comes to mind is confusion, thinking, really? I thought, well, all right. With joy, with guilt, some tears, and a whole lot of love. Some days it felt like there was things I was hiding. Some days it felt like I just wanted to throw caution to the wind and just figure out where I was going. So the journey into a different tradition, into a different livelihood, to something other than the education I spent 7 years training for, something of a different but similar ministry, has been a painful growing experience. But pain isn't always a bad thing. Pain is an indication of change. So I'm thinking when you feel a pain in your side, you take medicine, you feel a little worse for a bit, but all of a sudden you start to feel better. The pain was an indication something changed, and then the good kind of pain is that something is improving. And change is often an indication of movement. So if you're sitting in a dark room, you might have to move to turn on your light. If you're like me, your lamp is right above your head, and it's just out of reach if you reach up your hand, so you have to stand up to get your light. If you're in the basement, you have to climb up the basement stairs to get back out to the level with the light on it. It can be a pain to move. Some of us know all too well, if you sit in your chair for too long, it's really hard to get up. I confess that I love a good rainy day. I'm the kind of person where it's hard for me to get excited if there's not a cloud in the sky. I think, I'm gonna shrivel up. I won't be able to make it. But I know that once I'm in the light, once I'm walking around with a friend, once I have sunglasses and a baseball cap on, my skin starts to like the vitamin D. I start to like being outside in the light. I have felt a lot of joy, a lot of love in this stage of my life. The last 3 years as a pastor, the last 2 years here, I've felt such vibrant feelings. Some of my saddest points in life have occurred in this profession, such as having to do funerals for pillars of the church. I still remember a lot of those funerals, or so many firsts that occurred here. I watched somebody pass on into glory for the first time as a pastor, Or officiating weddings. That's something I never thought that I would really do until you're standing there and you're the pastor, like the person that you see in the movies. Or being the person where the buck stops. If something is going on, you let pastor know. It's like, oh my gosh, I'm that person. Sometimes just being asked to pray for somebody was such an honor. Or just being given little gifts. Hey, I found this and I thought of you. It was beyond touching to me. So in this last week, as I was looking over the readings for this Sunday and dreaming up what I wanted to talk about, I could find it, kind of feel this knot in the pit of my stomach. This is a difficult gospel passage. This is not the passage I would have chosen to use my last sermon on. Couldn't it have been something a little lighter? But no, this is the infamous passage of Jesus bringing the metaphorical sword. And it shows the harsh reality of Jesus. He is love, he is light, he is the Prince of Peace, but of ultimate peace. And sometimes he is sure to shake things up. So our lives should feel a little tense in this world. The world will often say, all there is money and the spending of it. It's not all there is. Jesus says that it's easier for a camel to get through the eye of the needle than for the rich person to get into heaven. There's something that Jesus is telling us to look for that is different than the world. And that is the harsh reality of Jesus. He will shake up our lives. We're reading Philippians in our Bible study in Messina. And it exposes just how challenging Paul's life was. You would think, as somebody who is, he says, I'm the Jew of Jews. I've been through all these different things. Circumcised on the eighth day, he says, I am like the man here. And he just gets persecuted. Almost all of his books are either from him in jail or him escaping death. I was reflecting on how easy it is for us to slip into the dark and kind of ignore where God might be pushing us because it's not comfortable. The dark is complex. It isn't always bad. It can be sleepy. It can be comforting. It can feel kind of like it's hiding shame. It gives us a moment to breathe. It covers up secrets. And we keep ourselves there because something feels like we don't want to expose ourselves to our God, even the person who created us. We kind of stay in the dark. We hide so we don't have to be exposed to the light, because the light can be painful. Though darkness isn't always bad. I read a book a couple years ago, Learning to Walk in the Dark. It's by Barbara Brown Taylor. And it was helpful for showing us that the dark can be comforting. Darkness has a propensity to bring things out in us. But there is a darkness that comes from turning away from God. As if God is a light and we're facing him, and then when we turn our backs, the light is behind us, but we don't see it. And that turning away, that darkness, can bring a narrative of self-hate. How easy it is to lean into self-hate because there's somebody else to blame. Because there's nobody else there but myself, so it must be my fault. That turning away from God into that darkness is problematic. The enemy becomes life itself. The darkness of turning away from God can also bring a pretty nasty habit of devaluing human worth. Even if we love people, I've had friends who say, well, I don't believe in God, but I love people. I ask where that love is coming from. Where is that stemming from? If it isn't grounded in your core being, from the creator of the universe, where is it from? I'm sometimes shocked and appalled by how little people can value other human life. I've been noticing online lately, it's especially kind of mean-spirited time, with this submarine accident and people cracking lots of jokes about the deaths of these people. The death of a person is never funny. jokes about the death of people, no matter how unintelligent we think the person was, it's never funny. You are of more value than many sparrows, is what the scripture says. You are of more value than many sparrows. And so are other people. And I'm a person who loves birds, so I'm like, if we're of more value than sparrows, and I like sparrows that much, we got it pretty good. The hope of God often comes to us while we're in the dark. Something speaks to us in that darkness, in that quiet place. It can be a dangerous place to be, but in that sleepy place to be, something speaks to us, and then it changes us. Sometimes it's really slowly. Sometimes it's like a door opening in the dark. It's first just like a crack of light, and it slowly widens into a triangle of light. And we are thankful for that. Life has new meaning. When the light shines on us, something changes. But then Jesus says we must share the message that is shared with us. That is the catch. We must share what we heard in the dark, in the light too. Not just whispered in some dark room to somebody else, but shared right out in the open. In that harsh light, sometimes it feels like it's burning our skin. Light is too much. But once we've been called out of the dark, we must live into the light. And it is going to hurt sometimes, as Jesus reminds us. It's kind of a harsh reality. Jesus came not to bring peace, but to bring truth. There is a saying that truth hurts, and boy, does it ever. But truth can bring peace. So we see evidence of what Jesus is saying in this passage. Sometimes our faith gets us in trouble with our families. Sometimes it makes it hard to make friends. You get kind of worried to show you're Christian on the outside. Sometimes it interrupts blooming romances. But our deep hope and a future can make people angry. And in the grand scheme of Christian history, that often caused us to be killed. But we know how it ends. Living in the open, living in the light, that is the truth. So I encourage us, friends, live into the light. Taking up our cross is not really our favorite thing to do. In fact, it's very painful. But if our Savior has done it and commands us to do the same, why shouldn't we? We have been equipped, and if you don't feel like you've been equipped, then you will be equipped shortly. The cross we bear is not forever, but the life we will live into is forever. We can and must be the support for each other on this walk. God longs for our hearts and for our lives to be lived open in the truth. So there is hope, there is much joy in store for us. Live into the light. Thanks be to God. Our Apostles' Creed is found on page 8 to 81, and we read that together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. Thence he shall come to judge quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. I'll invite my usher forward at this time, and we'll go into the time of the offering. Thank you. Holy God, you give to us in so many ways. At this time, we offer back just a token of our appreciation for you, whether it's in our time, in our words, in our prayers, in our songs. May you especially bless these monetary gifts. May they be a blessing not only for this church, but out into the community. Amen. Our prayers of the people are printed in the bulletin. We read these responsively. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work, for this community, the nation, and the world, for the just and proper use of your creation, for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for the peace and unity of the Church of God, for Bishop Hector, D.S. Whedon, and all bishops and other ministers, for the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
Praise your name forever.
We pray for all who have died that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, that your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Our closing hymn is God of Grace and God of Glory. We'll find that on 577.
Thank you.
closing prayer is as printed in the bulletin. Would you read that with me? Oh, you may be seated if you do so comfortably. God of love, you are with us in every transition and change as we enter into this new era with excitement and even some anxiety. We recall your deep compassion, presence, and abounding love. We thank you for the gifts, talents, and skills with which you have blessed us. We thank you for the experiences that have brought us to this moment. We thank you for the work of others that gives breadth and depth to our own work. Be with us as we move forward, rejoicing with you and supporting one another. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bring you peace. Go in peace.